start our worship service today with Jaden Johnson sharing with us how to. Jaden and Chase are in a theme, or the theme contest, or a. On Friday, so they're going to share their special talent with us, or just prepare our hearts and minds to worship as Jaden shares with us her special music. our Lenten video. Do we have our Lenten video ready to go?
Series Dare to Dream. Hi, my name is Ben Ingebretson. I'm the Area Director for New Church Development in the Dakotas and Minnesota Conference. In this session, we're going to think about the phrase, "What is it in your hand?" It's a direct excerpt from a conversation that God and Moses had on the occasion of Moses and his considerable doubts. God had a mission for Moses, and Moses was a bit skeptical. He says, "What if the people that you want me to lead don't believe that I'm the one to take them out of slavery?" And so he talks to God about that, and God tells Moses to take an everyday tool that he's very accustomed to from his years of working with Jethro in Midian as a shepherd, his staff. He was to throw that staff onto the ground. You can read all about it in Exodus chapter 4. See, Moses knew the purpose of his staff. A staff is to a shepherd what a hammer is to a carpenter, or what a spreadsheet is to an accountant. A staff is to a shepherd what a lesson plan is to a teacher, or what a wrench is to a mechanic. A staff is a tool. And we all know what to do with our tools. But now God wants him to release that staff, that tool. And the staff turns into a snake. And God says to Moses, "Do this, and the people will believe that the God of Abraham has appeared to you." God says, "Release this staff, Moses, and I will make it powerful for the purpose I have for you." This brief episode in the life of Moses calls out the potential impact our resources are to the kingdom if and when we release them for greater purposes. We must release it to increase it, to use Mike Slaughter's phrase. But pause with me for a minute. Think about that act of releasing. That act of releasing the gift you have in your head, or in your hands, or in your heart. It's a gift that's unique to you, and releasing it is not a simple thing. You see, it seems like we never really release one of those prized gifts or resources unless we fully surrender our plans or our expectations for it. So long as I have my agenda for how my gift or my ability will be used, I have put my qualifications on the release. The surrender is conditional. And so my pride creeps in a bit, my thoughts about how that resource should be used, my little roadmap for my life kind of takes over. A little confession is good for the soul here. Some time back, I experienced a season of transition during which I have to admit I was busy projecting my little roadmap onto the future. I thought, well, I'll move forward with my gifts if the situation fits my expectations, if it fits my plan. And then when a great opportunity came along that I really didn't fit with those expectations, really didn't fit with my plan, really didn't fit with my conditions, I almost dismissed it, except that someone close to me challenged me to stop a minute and be open, to surrender, to let God and his unfolding story for my life redefine the story I had all planned out. You see, I think there's often the need for some humility at that point of releasing. Perhaps the place for me to release my gift is a small and humble place. Or maybe I'll consider it kind of beneath me. Or maybe that act of surrender will put me in a new environment where I'm no longer in control. I'm out of my comfort zone. So altogether, this can be really humbling stuff. And yet this is exactly the place where God does his greatest work. Think about the Bible and the characters between those covers. The Bible is full of people in small, humble places, people out of their comfort zones, and yet that was the very condition for God to do a great thing through them. So maybe releasing is about humbling. Maybe releasing is about removing the conditions. Maybe releasing is about giving up control. But we have to release it to increase it. So the questions remain, I think, for us today. What's in your head? What's in your hand? What's in your heart? What are those unique tools and gifts that God has given to you? And then that next question to ask yourself, can I surrender my gifts to the God who has a good purpose for my life? Think about it and pray with me. God, you're the giver of every good gift. As we call to mind the gifts we hold in our head and in our hands and in our hearts today, help us to again place them before you, to use as you choose, for the sake of Christ and his kingdom.
Please stand for the call to worship. Let us test and examine our ways and return to the Lord.
God has blessed us. Let all the ends of the earth hear him.
Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and their unrighteous and their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord.
The sacrifice is acceptable to God with a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise.
Please remain standing for the songs of praise, number 2040, Awesome God, and number 2150, Lord Be Glorified. Sing them both two times. Let us pray. Gracious God, as your Son wept with Mary and Martha at the tomb of Lazarus, look with compassion on those who grieve. Grant them the assurance of your presence now and faith in your eternal goodness, that in them may be fulfilled the promise that in them, that those who mourn shall be comforted. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please read with me Psalm Act of Praise 848, Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications.
If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand?
But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be worshipped.
I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, in the Lord's word I hope.
My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning.
O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord is plenteous redemption.
And the Lord will redeem Israel from all iniquities.
O Lord, now open our hearts and our minds by the power of the Holy Spirit, that as the Scriptures are read, your word is proclaimed. We may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Today's scripture lesson is John 11, 1 through 45. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews tried to stone you, and yet you are going back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by the world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light." After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will forgive you, will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him, "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world." And after she said this, he went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he have opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his feet and hands wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary had seen what Jesus did put their faith into him. This is the word of the Lord. You may remain seated for the hymn of preparation, number 467, Trust and Obey.
Thank you. Thank you. acceptable in your sight, O Lord. For you are our rock, and you are our redeemer. Amen. In our lectionary reading for today, we have the story of the rising of Lazarus. And it may seem kind of odd to read this story right before Easter. But as we get a closer look at this story, it's perfect. And in this story, God's glory is revealed yet again. Jesus is the one that gives life. It also foreshadows Jesus' death for us to see. And as you study the scriptures, keep in mind how important the word see is important throughout the Gospel of John, and especially in our passage story for today. The narrator begins with a story, explains that Lazarus is ill, and Jesus comments to his disciples that through Lazarus, God's glory will be seen so that other people know that he is truly the Son of God. And Jesus tells his disciples that they will return to Judea. And here we see the disciples were very concerned about that because they tried to stone Jesus earlier. And Jesus escaped that unharmed. So why go back? Jesus explains to the disciples that Lazarus is now dead. And this would be a perfectly opportunity for them to believe. I like what Thomas says in the loyal statement. He said, let us go that we may die with him. So do we believe enough to go and die with Jesus? Now Lazarus has been dead. He's dead now. And many Jews came to visit Mary and Martha at the house. And Martha heard that Jesus was coming. So she goes out and meets him. And Martha believed that, you know, if Jesus was there earlier, Lazarus would not have died. Now Jesus tells Martha that he will rise again, and Martha acknowledges that because the resurrection was the common belief among the Jews. But Jesus takes it one step further. He tells Martha. He says, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Jesus brought eternal life then. And when Martha asked, or when he asked Martha if she believed this, she said, yes, I believe you are Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. Even though she might have a lack of understanding of that. Her faith and belief were strong enough to accept the mystery. Is it easy to believe when we cannot see? Now this portion of the text contains really raw emotions on everyone's part. Martha then tells her sister Mary that Jesus wants to see her. So Mary gets up quickly. The mourners think Mary is going to go to the tomb. And they follow her. But Mary goes right to Jesus. Mary begins to cry. She gets straight to the point, like Martha did. If you would only have been here, my brother would not have died. Now, Jesus is moved and disturbed by that death power. He saw Mary weeping and crying and trying to console her. And this caused Jesus to cry. Did you know that? That's the only time you see Jesus' emotion? tears in his eyes. Now the mourners gave mixed reviews of Jesus' tears. He said, look how much he loved his friend Lazarus. But other people still complained, saying, well, if he opened the eyes of the blind man, why did he not save Lazarus from dying? Are we accepting and moved by raw emotions? Or do we act like those mourners, trying to fix everything? So now we see Jesus and Mary and Martha and the mourners go to the tomb where Lazarus is laid. Jesus asked them to remove the stone. Martha questioned this, saying, you know, he's been dead for 4 days. He has that odor. To which Jesus replied to her, did I not tell you that you will believe and see the glory of God? And in this encountering, we have believing as seeing. In verse 45, we get the reverse. I quote, many of the Jews, therefore, who have come with Mary and have seen what Jesus did, believed in him. For here we have seen as believed. And for some, neither seeing nor believing works, because they're doubtful. And I believe they are the ones that were complaining about Jesus because he couldn't open the, you know, he opened the eyes of a blind man but couldn't save Lazarus from dying. These complainers went to the Pharisees and reported to what Jesus had done. But throughout this Lent season, whether we were in our Bible study or doing a little devotional downstairs or even here in church or even back before the Lent season started, we've seen people that have seen Jesus and believed. Last Sunday, again, we talked about the blind man. Jesus healed him. He saw and believed. The following Sunday was a Samaritan woman at the well. Believed and see and believed in Jesus. And she went out with. The previous Sunday was Nicodemus. In the middle of the night, he wanted to see Jesus. And he believed. And today, we have Mary and Martha, the crowds there, the mourners, seeing and believing Jesus. So my question for you, what do we see and believe as we prepare for Easter? What do we see and believe as we prepare for Easter? Let us pray. As Lazarus in the tomb heard your words of power, so have we. And on this day, grant us the power to stand up on renewal legs of faith. May we walk out of darkness into the light of righteousness. May the ministry of God's word remove our grave clothes and embrace us in the kingdom of God. And Lord, help us to see you working in our lives. I see the people around us that have helped us. came back earlier, but all right. I continue to pray with farmers. I know they're really out in the fields, and some are calving and all that. So busy tonight for a lot of you farmers. So you all our prayers as well. So that's what I'm kind of praying. Oh, breath of God, breathe in me. Call us out of the grave of self-reliance. Call us out of the grave of false security. Call us out of the grave of despair. And call us out from the grave of worry and the grave of petty theft or petty conflict. Call us out from the grave of unconfessed sins and the grave of crime. And Lord, call us out of the grave of isolation, the grave of broken promises. Call us out as you have called Lazarus and make us to live again, to live as your children, assured of eternal life, and able to give our very lives for others. We're grateful for this time together, O God, and be with those, Lord, that cannot be with us. And Lord, be with those that are maybe going through a difficult time. And Lord, be with those that are ill. And Lord, help us to see you in everyone. Help us to see you in a stranger. Help us to see you in our co-workers, our friends. Be, Lord, with all farmers as they are getting ready to prepare for the planting season. Lord, be with those people that are traveling. And Lord, we lift all this up to you as we pray now the prayer you taught us saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. And let us now confess our sins to God and to one another. Please join me now in our prayer confession that's on the screen or in your bulletins this morning. And let us pray. O Lord God, the watchers of Zion have called peace, peace, when there was no peace. Wherefore you have so long withheld from us the influence of your Holy Spirit. Why have you hardened our hearts? Is it because we have honored you with our lips when our hearts were far from you? Return again to us, O Lord God, and pardon this iniquity of your servants. Cause our face to shine upon us, and we shall be saved. O visit us with your salvation. Raise up sons and daughters from Abraham and Sarah, and grant that there might come a mighty shape of dry bones among us, and a great ingathering of souls. Be pleased to grant that the kingdom of our Lord generosity and sharing in the world. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, I'd like to thank Chase and Jada for sharing their music talents with us. They said they're nervous, and I said they should preach every Sunday. You get very nervous when you have to preach, but they did a good job, so appreciate it. We may find the fellowship downstairs and in the board meeting as well. So let's receive now the benediction. Go forth in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit